So with all this information then, PsyGuy, why still the support? Well, like I said, I think you're starting to see more and more people starting to see the light and rightfully questioning more and more, ultimately going over to the other side of supporters. As I stated earlier, yes, I think this is a classic case of concrete versus critical thinking. I also think that the folks who have seen this firsthand, like for example, you know, who are in the healthcare field, like the teachers, the counselors, the victims, the ones who have sadly gone through having been coached or endured parental alienation, I think these are the folks, in addition to the more prone, the folks that are more prone to engaging in critical thinking, are starting to wake up. All of the above are starting to wake up. And by the way, yes, parental alienation and coaching is also a form of ABUS / exploitation. Let's get that straight once and for all here. And if that did happen, well, then shame on the parent or any parent who does this. And what I think when the dust is all settled, more than likely it's going to be user has left the chat. Just a quick exodus of the leftover supporters on one side. Just like that. Either that or, you know, like a, well, we were all duped because we didn't have all the facts. So yeah, I mean, we were blindsided and yeah, so there. Well, no. A, we were all not duped. And B, you're right, we don't have all the facts, but there's something known as red flags, right? So you guys may be thinking, hey, PsyGuy, with all this, then why would there still be supporters on Dad's side? Again, I'm not saying he's a bad guy or think he's guilty yet. It's just that there is a lot that's not adding up here, as I laid out earlier. So why the support still, especially when you, PsyGuy, pointed out everything that you pointed out, you know, that's all public record and known already. Well, first off, we live in a very competitive society, and who wants to be on a losing team? You invest some money into something, you don't want it to go to waste, right? So I think a lot of people are giving the dad the benefit of the doubt, which is fine, but yeah, I get it. It's your hard-earned money, our egos want to be protected, and no one likes to be labeled a sucker. Even though we all have been conned at one point or many points in our lives, right? It's just that we gotta sometimes learn to take the L and move on. I think also our human civilization is partly to blame into this, as we have created this attraction for fairy tale themed stories. An attraction, a yearning for the unrealistic, happily ever after / feel good stories that have been replayed time and time again in the form of a warm, campy Hallmark movie or a good chicken soup for your soul kind of story. Basically a distractor, something to create a false sense of security and a pseudo-optimistic purpose in life. And what better story than the typical cowboy-looking guy riding down on his horse, sweeping up and saving the damsel in distress, that damsel being his young daughter, away from all the evils around her. Yeah, good versus evil. And the good being the dad now with his daughter, they're going to live happily ever after together in the castle far away from any and all dragons. The dragons being mom's boyfriend and anyone else who has allegedly victimized her. However, the reality is that there is no such thing as a utopia. There are no such thing as fairy tales. There's something called reality. And everyone, no matter what side you're on, has got to realize that now we're going to be dealing with a traumatized girl, whether she was victimized by sexabuse or parental alienation / coaching. And it's going to be rough, I'm not going to lie. I truly feel bad for folks like in her position. And it is highly insensitive for the father to just indirectly dismiss victims of abuse, parental alienation, domestic violence, whatever the case is. And he truly is, by the way, no question, by his posting all of her personal images and clips and violating her rights for everyone to see. And by his doing that, he's making a mockery out of victims, all the victims out there. Because I know that when they hear the story and see this poor little girl, and when dad is posting and blasting all these pics and vid clips, with a GoFundMe page almost appearing to just try to capitalize on the story because the GoFundMe page is still up and running, it really is insulting to all victims of ABUSE. Because I know when they see this poor little girl's face, they themselves see their face in her. It doesn't matter if they are in their 20s, 30s, 40s, 50s, 60s, 70s, 80s, 90s. It doesn't matter how old, because they too were Sophies at one point. So this blasting the images is only hurting every victim of ABUSE, because it only helps to facilitate an unraveling of repressed memories of what was tragically done to them back in the day, who now have to re-experience the trauma all over again thanks to the dad who seems to be recklessly posting the images of the girl. Like, I get if he only did that in the beginning to get the public's attention, but the day or two after this story caught fire, immediately respect society, including the girl, censor any and all images of her, stop the GoFundMe, and don't appear as if you're profiting like a thousandfold or whatever off your daughter, which it appears that you're doing. No children should have a price tag, just the price of unconditional love. Another thing of why there's so much support, I think, in this case, is the universality nature of ABUS, coupled with the fact that it involves a minor. There are a lot of folks out there who have unfortunately had traumatic lives, who are victimized in the form of ABUS. So they themselves see this little girl crying out, and they unconsciously take on the role as an ego protector, trying to protect the object, i.e. the girl, of which wasn't protected when they were younger. I guess the simplest way to put it is to think of like a transference neurosis, even though there's no psychoanalysis going on. But yeah, transference neurosis with a side of what you call, sounded to my tongue, rescue fantasy. I can't believe it. Yeah, rescue fantasy. That's it. So just think of it like transference neurosis with a side of rescue fantasy. And let me explain this for those. I forgot that my audience is not all of them in the psych field. So let me just go ahead and just kind of slow it down here and kind of explain it as best as possible. So, okay, Freud. Now, he's basically stated that during psychoanalysis, the psychoanalysis process, the psychoanalytical process itself can uncover what's called infantile neuroses, which basically manifests and expresses a psychic conflict that has been symbolically noted in the subject's early childhood, with that conflict in this example being in the form of ABUS. Now, during psychoanalysis, this infantile neurosis can be converted into something called transference neurosis, which are basically new versions of the patient's fantasies and impulses. And then this will lead to ultimate resolution through interpretation. In this specific example, again, going back to this specific example, with the resolution through the formation of a rescue fantasy complex with the goal of striving for a more perfect ego, i.e. an idealization of the ego, or in other words, ego idealization. Which is basically the inner image of oneself as what one wants to become. That oneself is to rescue and help out anyone vulnerable out there and try to prevent others from going through what they themselves had to go through in more primitive years. So that's why this specifically has become, and other campaigns similar to this, why they're all like, you know, very popular. Just hitting at the inner core of a lot of folks who have gone through such similar types of adversities in their more formative years, tween, preteen, and/or teen years. And lastly, just to be complete here, and I hope I don't alienate anyone here, but I'm Psych Guy and look at all aspects of a coin, not just the front and the back, but also the sides. But just to be thorough, there could be some women who are infatuated with the dad, because he's an okay-looking guy, let's be honest. I mean, you know, he's kind of charming, right? You know, in their minds, you know, there could be like a fantasy playing, like, you know, unconsciously playing, like, you know, this maverick-looking, rugged cowboy type who rode in on his horse and came to save the day. And they see themselves through the eyes of Sophie's, hoping that they too can be, just as she was, they too can be also whisked away from their mundane or their troubled or boring life or maybe they're having some conflict with their husband or spouse, or issues with their kids or something, you know, just something like that, where they're quickly whisked away and rescued by this rugged cowboy to ride into the sunset and live happily ever after, just like in all the stories that they read as a little girl. So they're seeing themselves as Sophie is a complete and different and opposite way than the folks on the other side, you know, the ones who were ABUS in the past, right? As if, you know, as them themselves are seeing themselves in Sophie, right? Again, this is all unconsciously. But yeah, it's like an extreme form of fanaticism. And you see that, you know, going back to that, you know, the infatuations and so on, you know, you see that type, you know, in such women, more so the insecure females who cannot find love in normal ways, or the love-avoidant females who seek romantic relationships that cannot be consummated, especially when Courtney's in the way, right? So yeah, it's just like, you know, this big old romantic fantasy, right? Let's see what else here. I'm just trying to get this all out on the fly, on the top of my head. You know, once and for all, you know, as this is the last video on this topic, at least for me, you know, to close the books. Let's see. Oh! You know, in Dad's defense, we cannot say that he's bipolar just based on a phone call. You know, there's this phone call floating around, okay? I think it's from 2017. In fact, I did review the phone call, and his talking about angels to Sophie didn't bother me at all. What rather bothered me about the call were two things. Number one, when he mentioned how he doesn't have any money yet, so he can't buy big, big things. Those were his quotes, his words, actual words, okay? And by the way, promising gifts is a potential red flag of coaching, okay? All right? Just as potential. I mean, again, these are hypotheses. And number two, the other thing that bothered me was the tone of his voice in the beginning of the phone call and the hypocrisy behind it. On one token, portraying all this admiration for his daughter, which I'm sure he has, but then on the same token, calling the child's biological mother a W-H-O-R. Yeah, I'm sure that's going to work out real well later in life when she's old enough to figure out what all this means, bro. Also, since this is still an active court case, I'm not going to get into specifics about potential diagnoses in either parent, just out of respect for both sides and the overall court process. Yes, I have my own thoughts, but again, just staying out of it, just out of respect. And yes, there could be that M word going on. I'm not going to say it, but my gosh, you got to admit, things look a little shady and suspicious, especially when one side is changing lawyers more often than I take my car for an oil change. And for those out there who don't know, that's definitely not a good sign, because that could possibly be because his or her lawyers got sick of him or her because of his or her non-compliance and probably fired him or her. You don't want to see that revolving door kind of thing in such a serious case like this, as it would only disrupt the flow of your case building, in my humble opinion. Let's see what else. Oh, that reminds me. Earlier this week, there was this channel. Actually, there were two people. Two YouTubers. I'm not going to mention any names. I don't play that game. But it was on Sunday, this past Sunday. And again, I'm not interested in any sort of fights. But when I see BS, I'm going to call out BS, all right? First off, forget that there is nothing substantial in this video, on that Sunday night, on that video, right? Nothing new to add to the table. It was just an hour-long video with no real substance or facts. And one of them supposedly has direct contact to the dad and hence the girl, right? Since she's staying, you know, at the dad's house right now, right? At his house right now, right? But nothing. Nothing about how the girl's doing. You know, how has she been coping about, you know, after the alleged trauma. Nothing. It was just basically an hour ranting about other YouTubers. Look, people don't want to hear about other YouTubers. With this case, they don't care about other YouTubers. They don't care about the YouTubers. In the end, they could care less about me or whomever the YouTube creator is. All they really care about, and understandably so, is the girl and her overall well-being. But nothing. And if that were bad, these two YouTube creators tried to come across as trying to be objective and in the middle, when clearly it's obvious who they're aligned with. Like with me, I've defended the dad and have nothing against him. In fact, earlier in this video, I stated that we can't be quick to judge in terms of diagnosing someone with bipolar just based on a phone call. But when there was something as egregious and really highly inappropriate, such as the dad calling the mom a WHOR, listen, I don't care if it's in the heat of the moment or not, but no woman, absolutely no woman should ever, and I mean ever, be called the W word. It was pathetic how they just downplayed it. Complete minimization. I think one of the YouTubers were like, oh, my ex-boyfriend used to call me that. And I think the other YouTuber said, it's not right. However, it has nothing to do with this case. By the way, I would re-listen to, you know, that clip again, but I just ate Chipotle and I don't want to vomit. But A, it completely 100% has everything to do with this case, as it just shows which parent has the better temperament and which one doesn't probably realize that post-conflict parental divorce is the number one risk factor to negative potential psychiatric sequelae popping up in the children later on. And B, your docile and rather passive acceptance by not taking a firm stand and taking a courageous attempt, especially on a large platform, right? By not calling out the dad, is the reason to why there is still no equality of sexes and to why we are still living in a state of perpetual, persistent, and rather predisposed misogynism. What's the best way to put it? In other words, it was like a rather unwarranted and unnecessary and superfluous pro-androcentric move that you made there. As if we don't have enough of that already. That was a big time oops move moment, man, my gosh. Look, maybe the only exception I can go ahead and grant, you know, the name calling, like the WHR, if maybe the individuals have an acute altered mental status change secondary to like an intracerebral process, like a midline shift, or maybe going through like a neuroleptic malignant syndrome, you know, with a resultant high fever, noted rigidity, leukocytosis, and confusion, right? I'll make an exception, okay? Or even like a serious chronic neurodegenerative disorder, like a frontotemporal dementia. But sorry, any other situation? Nope, no pass here, bro. It was just terrible, the entire interview. I was so mad also because I was like, I missed the Packers-Saints ending for this trash. It was terrible. And I don't want to sound too mean, but there are like two people just talking, no fact-checking. There are too many mistakes or things that were wrongly said. I mean, they both seem like nice people in real life. But yeah, I think it was over both of their heads. It almost appeared as if, you know, strings are being pulled. I may be wrong, but you could tell that, you know, there was just this inherent bias. Their main argument was like, you know, going after another one of their main arguments was like going after another YouTuber, or other YouTubers, or maybe, I don't know if it's one or many, I don't know. I can't remember. It was so forgettable, but who quote unquote cherry pick when they themselves were doing this. For example, you know, when they're talking about the phone call, it was, you know, they're just talking about one part of the phone call, the Angels part, when all along missing the most important part, the potential coaching with the promising of gifts. Some other quick corrections, if you did happen to listen to that interview, there are two obvious ones on top of my head here. Number one, I should say, Texas is a one-party state, and as long as one party is aware of the recording, it's legal. Mother knew about the phone call, and Sophie's a minor, and since mother has full custody of Sophie, her awareness about the phone call is valid and legal, and the parent, in this case mother, consents for the minor. You know, one of the creators pointed out correctly that Texas is a one-party state, but they both completely dropped the ball on this point. And the other thing, number two, was self-mutilatory behaviors, such as cutting, can be coached, unlike with one of the creators wrongly stated. These are all the folks, these folks, I think they're sticking by the dad's side. They seem enmeshed. with that, in my humble opinion. And I think they're being taken for a ride. And they may have a big wake-up call coming soon. In fact, I think a lot of Sadat supporters will have a big wake-up call. That's just my opinion. Okay, so to conclude here, bottom line is this. The actual court matters, not the court of public opinion. In most cases, if the child has been living with one parent for some time, in this case in mom's house, right, and that child's needs are being adequately met under that parent's care, and that parent is capable of continuing to care for the child, it is not in the child's best interest to disrupt that successful arrangement. Rather, it is in the child's best interest to preserve it. Belief that the other parent might be a little better in some areas ought not suffice to disrupt a child's satisfactory home life with the caretaker parent. This is what the court is going to follow. Now, I stated before, if the dad has something stored up for the next court hearing, whoa, then my gosh, look out. I'm kind of leaning like I know what's going to happen. I think it's going to disappoint a lot of people, as I stated earlier. Don't expect to see any major changes. Unless dad has something in his back pocket, which I doubt, don't expect a complete reversal of custody. The hearing will just go through the motions, and result will probably go back to what it was before, how it was set up before, or the judge, who knows, the judge could relinquish complete rights of the dad and terminate them. If the evidence is strong against him and or they're just frankly sick and tired of him. I've actually seen that happen, especially in folks who violate gag orders, as appears dad has done. Courts are going to frown down on that, and expect that to be a major point in the case. If there's evidence submitted of professional testimony of experts that suggest possible alienation, then forget about it. It's DOA before it even started. And I can see the end result not falling in dad's favor, and dad continuing and saying, you see, this is what I'm talking about, the unfairness of the courts. And this will further validate the existence of his GoFundMe and why he will continue to accept money from people as long as he can. The danger though is that if at any point during all this, if there is any suspicion of any sort of fraud, 10 times out of 10, it ends badly. The Federal Trade Commission is one organization that you do not want to mess around with. Don't believe me? Just ask these guys. All right, well, thanks guys for watching this video. I really appreciate it. Thanks to those who subscribe to this channel. By the way, heads up, I'm a small time channel, like I mentioned. I will be taking a little break. I do this in spurts, okay? Because in my real life, I'm a very, very busy physician, okay? So I have barely time to go ahead and make these videos. But I'm going to try to free up some time later on this year. But I can tell you this much, for the next week or two or a couple weeks, I'd probably be kind of, okay, busy with my real life kind of stuff going on. Yet, I will be returning soon, so no need to, you know, to not subscribe. Don't think I'm going anywhere. Don't think I dropped off. Just roll with me, because trust me, there is going to be plenty more to come. Just giving you a heads up. So yeah, because I'm a small-time channel, I would definitely subscribe for you, because I'm hard to find. I don't even know what topic my next topic is going to be about. It may not be anything about crime-related stuff. Who knows? I don't know. So you may never see me again. So yeah, just be safe and sorry. That's just my opinion. It's up to you. Anyways, to end this video right here, you know, at the end of my videos, I'm notorious for putting like the credits and throwing in a good song, right? For music, right? Like, still the last, you know, my last video, right? Hot song. I mean, my gosh, right? That song was so on fire. This video will be no different, because this song is also hot. It's a song actually, I remember back in the day, in the 2000s, I was actually listening to Sirius Radio, and I was thinking, okay, what song should I put, and then the song just came out of the blue, and I'm like, whoa, this song's perfect. I think this will be a song that some folks, not a lot, because I think a lot of people are now waking up and smelling the coffee, but I think some folks will be singing, you know. And anyways, it is a, I'm a huge Beatles fan. It is very, very, very Beatlesque, which is why I think I like that song a lot. It's actually, the lyrics actually are based off a Beatles song. So yeah, cool, check it out. You guys, that's right, you guys rock. Anyways, I am out, I gotta eat some lunch here. So as Ringo says, peace and love, we out.
just can't think for you. I can hardly hear you say